gone through the IMRAD structure, written up the paper, understood what happens in an editorial office, talked about how we should perfect our language and style. So I think Rakesh has emphasized this, but I'd like to re-emphasize this. Sometimes what we use in common usage on a day-to-day basis may be fine for us. It may not be fine when we do the same thing with an international audience or with a larger group of people. Because the jargon that we use in our day-to-day practice may be something different in another institution or another area or a region of the world. So therefore, you could actually, using inappropriate language, be misunderstood. And that's something that you don't want to do. But presuming we've now got the perfect paper, we need to now decide which journal should we send a paper to. And what is important is to look at a number of characteristics of a journal and then choose which one to send it to. In most instances, those of you who submitted a paper and have had it published, even if you haven't had it published, even if you've just submitted a paper, what you would have realized is that a senior person would have told you, submit to so-and-so journal. And behind that, submit to so-and-so journal would be years of experience of which journal to submit to and which is the appropriate journal to submit to. When you get to that level, you also want to make those judgments as quickly and as rapidly as you want, as you can. But we're not really taught how to do this, and therefore it's a good idea to learn what to look at when you want to choose a journal. So there are a number of things that we want to look at before we decide which journal to choose to send our paper to. And these are some of those, not all of them, but some of those which I think are important, which I've discussed with my colleagues, and we all feel that this is useful. And therefore, you could use this to decide whether you wish to send your paper to a particular journal or not. Now, this is not to say that this is the be-all and end-all of it, or this is gospel truth, and you must use only these and these criteria and nothing else. There could be many more criteria that you could use, but generally you would want to use these criteria. So when we say quality, what do we mean? How do we decide what is a good quality journal? Anybody?
Impact factor.
Impact factor.
Based on
so what do you want
index
to by an impact factor?
So maybe the score which is given to each journal based on the number of reads for the articles and like those things.
So an impact factor is not given to each and every journal that is available in the world. The impact factor is given only to those journals which are included in a particular database. All right. So a journal which is included in Medline may not necessarily have an impact factor. An impact factor would be available only for journals which are included in the Science Citation Index. So the Science Citation Index is a much more exclusive database abstracting indexing service than, say, Medline, where the total number of journals included in the Science Citation Index, for example, they're much more now. But at one point in time, if for all sciences there were 5,000, then in Medline, for health sciences alone, there were 5,000. And when you say Science Citation Index, then it covers all sciences, therefore it could cover life sciences, yes. Not only the life sciences, to cover animal sciences, to cover physical sciences, chemical sciences, you name it and every science was included. So from mathematics to through physics, chemistry, and everything else. And those total journals were just 5,000. So from India at one point in time, there were just a handful of journals, four, in fact. When I started getting interested in journals and trying to understand them, there were only four journals from India which were included in the Science Citation Index, which meant if you looked at Indian journals, there were only four with an impact factor. So yes, impact factor would be one possible thing. And why do you think of impact factor straight off? What is so great about the impact factor? Do you know how the impact factor came into being? So a gentleman by the name of Eugene Garfield, who used to work for something called the Institution for Scientific Information, ISI, which was a private organization based in the US, decided that librarians found it difficult to choose which journals to subscribe to because their budgets were limited. And therefore, he developed a numeric factor to help them choose which journals they should subscribe to. And that factor was called the impact factor. Okay, so the purpose with which the impact factor was started was very different from the purpose for which it is used now. You also must remember that if I have a paper published in a high impact journal, it doesn't necessarily mean that my paper will have a high number of citations. All that it means is that I've been published in a high impact factor journal. That's all, nothing else. So it's important to understand what is the impact factor, where it comes from, what it is used for, and how it can be misused. So the impact factor can be misused. There was a journal called the World Journal of Gastroenterology, it still exists. They were debarred from the Science Citation Index for a total of 5 years. Why? Because they used to send an acceptance letter to their authors with a line which said, it will be useful if you were to cite the following papers in your article. And there, what they were doing was giving them a list of references of papers that were published in the World Journal of Gastroenterology. So therefore, they increased their citations of the World Journal of Gastroenterology, and therefore hugely impacted their impact factor, falsely got it elevated. Similarly, if I were to work in a field which was not a very popular or a very cutting edge field, there may not be too much research going on in that area, and there may not be too many people working in that field, and therefore not the need for citing papers very frequently. And hence, I would have a lower impact factor journal in that field. So if you were to publish in radiology or in dermatology compared to general medicine, the highest impact factor journal that you could go to would be 9 or 10. On the other hand, if you went to a general medical journal, the highest impact factor journal would be 50 or above. So depending upon the field that you're publishing in, again, there is a limitation to the impact factor. As long as you're aware of these limitations, that's fine. So one of the things that you look for as far as quality is concerned is the impact factor. What else? No? Okay, so inclusion in abstracting and indexing services. So some of the better indexing and abstracting services, amongst the better indexing and abstracting services, is Medline. Now, what is the difference between PubMed, Medline, and PubMed Central? If anybody knows, please let me know. No? No one? Okay. So Medline, PubMed, and PubMed Central are three different things. PubMed is like a search engine. It's like Google. It searches through multiple databases that exist in the National Library of Medicine of the United States of America and various other databases. So it will search through genetic databases, it will search through journal databases, it will search through article databases, and so on and so forth. Medline is a database which indexes a certain set of journals based on their quality. And they assess these journals on a regular basis. A certain percentage of the journals keep getting assessed on an annual basis. Not all journals can obviously be assessed on an annual basis, but they keep getting assessed on a certain regularity. And if they continue to maintain their standards, they continue to be included within the Medline indexing database. The other indexing databases that are used, we'll talk about in a minute, but PubMed Central is different from PubMed and Medline. As I said, PubMed is a search engine. Medline is a database of journals or a database of articles of journals which are indexed in Medline. But PubMed Central includes generally open access journals which conform to a certain set of criteria. In addition to that, it also includes articles which by law are required to be published in an open archival system. So essentially, it is an open archival system where where articles are archived for posterity. So if you work in the US, you're funded by a public funding service, then by law, you need to put your articles into a public repository. And that public repository happens to be in the US, happens to be PubMed Central. Okay, so PubMed Central therefore could have an occasional article from a journal which is not listed in Medline, which is actually not included in PubMed Central, but has gone there because it was funded by, and therefore by US law required to be put into a public repository. And that's why that particular journal's article is listed out there. But often you don't look at each one of these things. And in your own field, you look at the prestige of a journal. So I'm a surgeon, and therefore generally people in the surgical field know that the Annals of Surgery is considered to be amongst the best journals in surgery. Similarly, for each field, you look at the prestige of the journal rather than look at whether they're indexed in an X, Y, Z indexing service or whether their impact factor is whatever. So most often this prestige of journal includes all these things, and that's how one gets to this point. Index Copernicus, you heard of this?
Yes, sir.
No? Yes, you have. Google Scholar. Heard of it?
Yes, sir.
Okay. So Google Scholar and Index Copernicus are two databases which people have used, not used, but abused. So Google Scholar will search the World Wide Web. And anything that's available which is scholarly will get included under Google Scholar. It doesn't mean that for a minute that this particular journal or this particular article is of a certain quality. So as long as there is no firewall which Google cannot bypass, if it can bypass a firewall, even if the firewall exists, it'll just trawl the World Wide Web and pick up anything that looks scholarly. Index Copernicus is an indexing service which is based in Poland, but is a little dodgy as far as the quality of work that they do. The reason is that we are given to understand that anybody and everybody who publishes a journal can get their journal indexed in Index Copernicus on the payment of a regular fee. A fee for first year evaluation, which essentially is nothing. You just pay the money and you get evaluated and you get selected. And then you pay a certain sum of money every year to continue to be within Index Copernicus. This is what some of the other databases do not do. H-Index is, in contrast to all these, an index which is used to assess the quality of work of an individual. There is an H-Index for journals also, but generally it is used more commonly to assess the quality of work of individual researchers. The next criteria that one wants to look at is the readership of a journal to see whether the message that you wish to convey is going to reach an appropriate audience. For example, if the field that I'm working in or the paper that I have with me, which is ready now, is likely to be of multidisciplinary interest. So suppose I was looking at gestational diabetes. Now, this is something that would interest obstetricians and gynecologists, as well as endocrinologists. It might even interest the internist, the general medicine medical physician. So therefore, I might want to choose a journal which would be read by these groups of people. I could also be interested or working in an area in a disease which is localized to or is present in a region. For example, I mentioned, I think yesterday or maybe day before yesterday, Kaisenor Forest disease. And the reason I mentioned it is a reading a proof recently about the Kaisenor Forest disease. And KFT seems to be limited to a certain area, a geographical region in India. So therefore, if I were to talk about KFT at an international level, there may not be that much interest as there may be in India, number one. Number two, the interest may be short lasting there. They may publish that one-off paper because it's something that is intriguing, it's something that's of interest, and it's something that journals might want to do, create awareness amongst their readers of different kinds of diseases in different populations. But they may not be interested in doing in a repetitive manner. So if there have been two papers on KFT in a general medical journal which is not focused on India, then it's unlikely they would go ahead and publish a third or a fourth or a fifth. And therefore, you need to take a region on whether a call on whether the region in which you've done the study is of relevance as far as choosing a journal is concerned. So you may want to look at an Asia Pacific journal, you may want to look at an Indian journal, you may want to look at a European journal, or you may want to look at a journal which is read by a much wider audience, which is within quotes international. Now, I don't know what is an international journal, so don't ask me what is an international journal to define an international journal, because I can't define one. You also want to go to a journal where the peer review process is fair and efficient. You don't want to go and submit your paper to a journal which doesn't do peer review and therefore will publish exactly what you sent to them with all the spelling mistakes, all the grammatical errors, and all the typographical errors, because this is being published under your name. So there could be somebody else who would read the paper and say, God, these people don't even know how to write English or write properly, or they can't even check their own articles and correct, do a proper proofreading. But the problem is that you never had the opportunity to do that because the journal never sent this stuff to you. The other thing that you want is a peer review process which is efficient. Unfortunately, in India, the peer review processes are largely inefficient because all of our reviewers generally, not all, but a large number of our reviewers take their own sweet time to review. And as I said the other day, good peer reviewers are scarce people. They're not very common and very, very easily available. So therefore, they are often hard pressed for time. A lot of journals would approach them because they're good, they're efficient. And therefore, you need to go to a journal which has a fair and efficient peer review process. If your work is a general, addresses a general audience, say for example, anemia, then you might want to look at a general medical journal. On the other hand, if you worked in a very focused area, fetal ultrasound, for example, then I might want to look for at a journal which is very, very focused and pertain to that particular speciality totally. My article is a case report, and this question came up a few days ago in this course only when somebody asked me, people don't publish case reports, journals don't publish case reports. So if a journal doesn't publish case reports, there's no point choosing the journal to send a case report to, because they're very, very likely to reject it out of hand. And therefore, you just waste those 3 or 4 days that it takes for the journal to take a decision. Plus, you waste the effort of trying to submit this paper to a journal, and there's no point doing it. Similarly, there are journals which focus on review articles. They are largely journals which are review-based. So these journals, these review-based journals, there's no point sending them an original paper because they don't publish original papers. Whether it's current opinion in gastroenterology or current opinion in any of the other. So the current opinion journal series generally tend to publish reviews. Similarly, there are other such journals, and there's no point sending a review that you've written up to these kind of journals. Some journals focus on public health. Other journals focus on clinical practice. And there could be other focus areas for different journals. If you look at the preamble that most journals have on their website, you would get a fair idea of what they are looking for. And that is what you should look for. If you don't find it anywhere else on their website, if it's not there on the homepage, then just go to the instructions to authors and or the instructions to contributors, and you would find a beginning paragraph which would generally tell you what they're interested in. And you could then take a call on whether your paper fits those general criteria. Look at the punctuality and the availability of a journal. Does the journal come out punctually or does it not? Number one. Number two, look at its availability. I once published a paper in a journal and then realized that the journal didn't come to our library. This was in the days when we didn't have the World Wide Web and we did not have emails and things appearing, you know, you could ask somebody, request somebody and get a PDF very quickly. So once the paper had been published, we wanted to access the paper. So we had a proof, but beyond that, when we asked the journal to send us a copy of the paper, they said you'll have to ask for reprints or buy a copy of the journal. They didn't send you any free copies and they didn't send you any reprints free. So therefore you must be careful when you publish. So if there is lack of availability of a journal, you of course can't read it, but there are obviously others also who can't read it. So publishing in an open access journal therefore is good, but it has its own drawbacks and we'll talk about it when we talk about pseudo journals. You then need to look at the editorial requirements of the journal. The length of the manuscript. I have a 2000 word manuscript. It's for a brief report or a brief communication or a short report. And the requirement is that my word length should be 1500 words. Now, either I sit down and cut from my paper 500 words, which could be difficult, or I look for a journal which allows me 2000 words. Next is tables and figures. So some journals may say that if you send a particular kind of paper, the tables that you can publish are 4 and the figures that you can publish are 2. Often this is related to correspondence columns, but certainly some journals talk about this requirement in short reports, brief communications and research letters too. And if you have a set of figures which cannot just be reduced from 6 or 7 or whatever you've got, or a 6 or 7 tables, then there's no point going to this journal. 1 or 2, they might, you know, bend backwards if your science is great, but often they will not. And in some journals, the electronic submission sites are configured in such a manner that you cannot actually upload more than the number of figures that they say you should be able to upload for a particular kind of article. And therefore, that could be a limitation in choosing a particular journal, and you might decide to go to another journal. Trial registration, and you're all aware of the fact that you need to register clinical trials. Now, the definition of a trial for an ethics committee is different from the definition of a registration of a trial for registration per se. In India, if you do research, it is mandatory by most or required by most ethics committees that you register your article with the Clinical Trial Registry India. If you have a collaborator, a co-funded project, and your trial is across 2 or 3 nations, then you could go ahead and register it in a registry other than Clinical Trial Registry India. But otherwise, the requirement is that you register under CTRI. If you have a trial and you've not registered it before enrollment of the first patient, then it is quite likely that the journal where you submit, which has a requirement of trial registration, will decline to publish your paper. And that's something that you should be aware of, and therefore submit only to a journal which allows you to register or allows you to publish a paper which has not been registered but is considered a trial. There are journals of that kind. They're not very high on the impact factor list, yes, but there are enough of them out there. So if you have done a study and by mistake not registered something that was actually a trial, then you could go ahead and publish in one of these journals. Look at the cost that you would incur. Today, there are a large number of open access journals. Some of them are pseudo journals, or may I say, take the liberty of saying that quite a few of them are pseudo journals. And you've got to be careful in trying to publish in these journals because of a lot of ifs and buts associated with the publication in pseudo journals. So if there are paid charges, and the paid charges or the publication charges are a large amount, which you may find difficult to pay, 40,000 rupees, for example, $2,000, £1,500, you need to ask yourself, can I pay this? Am I interested in doing this? So therefore, this is something that could decide whether or not you publish in a particular journal. Color reproductions. So if you've got color in your So you've got a histophoto micrograph which you want to publish, and or you've got a color picture that you want to publish because you wish to show a lesion which is of a different color from the adjacent normal looking tissue. So this is a gross photograph, and this some journals may require you to pay $200, $300, $500 for a single reproduction of a color picture. If that is so, you've got to again ask yourself whether you should publish here or you should publish, find another journal which does not charge for color reproductions. For example, the National Medical Journal of India doesn't charge, but a lot of other journals do charge, and therefore you should be aware of that. You should also be aware of reprints and offprints. Reprints are reprints of what is printed in the journal exactly in that format. So if your paper starts halfway on a page, then they would give you a reprint where your paper actually starts halfway and the top half would be blank. These are called reprints. Offprints are where your page is adjusted to start at the top. So these are now offprints, different from reprints. So most journals would give you some reprints free, but a lot of the journals would give you charge you for reprints and offprints. Today, if you get hold of a final PDF of your paper, that's good enough. And you could make as many copies or send the PDF out to as many people as you wish to. Copyright laws, especially if you published in a journal which publishes under a strict copyright law, will tell you that you can do fair use of that article by distributing it for personal use to a number of people for educational purposes, but not for commercial purposes. But if you published under the Creative Commons license, and you, how would you know that you published under a Creative Commons license? The journal on one of its masthead pages would have the symbol CC, not just C within a circle, but CC within a circle. So that's a Creative Commons license, which is of different kinds, but most of them allow free distribution of your work to as many people as you wish to. When should you decide which journal to choose and send your paper to? The earlier you decide, the better it is. How do you decide? You discuss it with co-authors. Why should you decide early? Because you've written up the whole paper and then you decide which journal you wish to send to. You might need to restructure the paper. You might need to change the emphasis of the paper. So it's always better to know which journal you're going to send the paper to first. Obviously, the second, third, fourth could also be shortlisted at the same time. And if all of them have the same stylistic thing, then that's fine. But otherwise, you would have to change it every time you got a rejection. So how do you choose a journal? Discuss with your co-authors. Look at possible journals. And this you should do early on in your careers. Once you're set in your careers, once you've already published 50 papers, you have enough experience and may not need to do all this. But once in a while, a new journal, a journal that is coming up in which you've not published previously, it's always a good idea to look at it before you decide to publish your paper there. Always shortlist a few of these journals and then decide which one to send them to, in which order, depending upon the quality of the journals. So prepare your manuscript. If you've decided the journal early enough, aim to send the journal to the paper to a journal which is likely to reject your paper. Not in-house, but after sending it out for peer review. Because you would then get a set of comments which would help you improve your paper. So if I think my paper is likely to be accepted in the Annals of Surgery, I would send it to Lancet or the New England Journal of Medicine or the BMJ or JAMA. If I think it's likely to be accepted in Annals of Surgery, I might send it off to, they're likely to be accepted in the British Journal of Surgery, I might send it to the Annals first. So depends on where you are likely to get published. You get a sense over a period of time. You always try and go a notch or two higher to try and get comments which would help you improve your paper. Is this fair? No, it's not. But we do it all the time for the simple reason that it helps us get peer reviews and pick up errors that we may not have been able to pick up while working again and again on that paper. Revise your paper based on these comments and then submit to the next one. If you try hard enough, you will ultimately succeed in a journal of appropriate standards and of your choice. always have a checklist. What is most suitable for my paper? What is most likely to accept my paper? What is the usual time between submission and publication? And most journals will tell you what their average time is between submission and publication. And look at the editorial policies and requirements, the length of the paper and the format in which they want it. So if you fit in here things and they suit you, then choose a journal which comes closest to using this checklist. Any questions?
Sometimes the journals have a policy that if the paper goes beyond a certain number of pages, then they charge paid charges, even if it's within the word limit or the number of tables and figures are what they said. So how do we make sure that our article is within the page limit and avoid those charges?
So the only thing you can do is to actually flow that article in the same format, in a double column format in Word, and see, or if it's a three column format of that journal, you can actually flow that into a Word format, double column spacing, single line spacing, which most journals have, using the same point size as the journal uses, and get a rough idea of, you will still not get an exact idea, but get a rough idea of the number of pages you're making up. And you could then decide whether this is going to be okay or not for that particular journal. There are very few journals which actually do that. I know there are a few who do it, but generally if they say 5,000 words and five tables, and if you are within 5,000 words and five tables, then even if it went beyond a seventh, eighth, or the tenth, ninth or tenth page, they won't charge you. But there are a few journals which would do that. The only solution is what I've told you. Actually place it in the format that the journal needs it to be able to make out rough guess as to how many pages it go through.
Okay, thank you, sir.
Okay.
So once we cross the limit for tables or figures, can we utilize, I mean, can we submit this as supplementary files? And is there a limitation in what data you can put into supplementary files or supplementary data?
So generally, supplementary data is data that is available with you, but is not of consequence in understanding the paper itself. It may be useful for a person who wishes to redo your work or understand your work in depth. So somebody working in the same field doing a similar study may want some details which are not usually available, and therefore that information can go into supplementary data. A journal editor would look at your paper, and if they say that they want only five tables and your data is running into nine tables, and they feel that the other four tables are useful, they might say that the print version of the journal will carry these five tables. The rest will be put into a supplementary data file. So they could decide to do that, or you could upfront decide that data which doesn't strictly need to be told to readers can go into supplementary files. Sometimes people would want their master charts, all the raw data, to be made available as a form of a supplementary file. If that is so, you need to do that. This will obviously not get published. Sometimes when you do questionnaire-based studies, and there are multiple questionnaires, some of them, those which you've created and then validated, then some of the final validated questionnaire may get published in the main issue of the journal. But the processes of validation that may have happened, and the different version of the questionnaires, that the initial questionnaire and the revised questionnaire and the final questionnaire, those multiple versions may actually go into supplementary data. So supplementary data is data that I don't need if I am a usual reader of the journal to understand what is written in the paper. Does that help?
Yes, sir. Thank you, sir.
Okay. I have no problem if you want me to explain something further, or you have a cross question, or you think that what I've said is not clear enough. I'll be happy to try and explain again or explain it in a different way. No? Okay. So we'll then move on to the second part of the talk, which is on pseudo journals. And pseudo journals are also known as predatory journals. Or maybe I should go the other way around, because the name predatory came first and the name pseudo journals came later. So now you often get these kind of emails, what you see currently on the screen in your inbox. I received this in 2015, not that it started in 2015, it started earlier, but around that time I found the need to prepare this talk, and this is from one of those times. It said that this journal had an impact factor of 0.52. It also said that it was an ISI indexed and approved journal. Now, ISI, you might have heard me say, the Institute for Scientific Information, Eugene Garfield. And ISI comes from there. It's an acronym there. So there are a lot of things here which are mentioned which are actually all false. Nothing is true here. So they entice you with these emails. If you look carefully, management and humanities are certainly not very close to each other. International Journal of Management and Humanities. So these kind of journals, journals which have a very wide base, they'll publish anything and everything under the sun, as long as it can be remotely called science, are journals which are actually trying to make money and make as much money as they can. So the more they publish, the more money they can make. Over a period of time, these people became smarter, and I started getting these kind of mails. These mails were addressed to me by name. They usually asked me to write a paper in a field that I had recently written on, and it often gave me a very short timeline. If you look here, 28th of February, and they will process it, means publish it in the March issue. Now that's something interesting and intriguing, because no peer review process and editing and publish can happen in that short period of time, unless you do hardly any peer review and hardly any editing. Yes, then you can go ahead and do this.